So I think the important thing about that comes from this is, I think we all assumed that any abuse of tramadol or any abuse potential tramadol had was because of the way it activated the opioid receptors in the brain. And that may not be the case. You know, it's pretty well accepted that opioid drugs like oxycodone and hydromorphone, hydrocodone, you block the opioid receptors in the brain, folks aren't gonna, you know, aren't gonna abuse the drug. So that would be a good intervention for that. You know, if you can somehow encapsulate those drugs with an opioid blocker, so that they don't get high if they misuse it. And that work has been done. Tramadol, it might indicate to us that an intervention like that might not be as effective. But what's also important is that assuming that the abuse potential tramadol lies in its opioid effects is not necessarily correct, that there's something else potentially going on. So those are sort of the two takeaway messages that I was left with when we were processing the data. We didn't actually assess pain in this study, so that's important to state. But you know, I think it's important. But you know, an implication is that tramadol can be abused and can be diverted. So folks who are receiving it, you know, need to be on guard for that for themselves or for their loved ones, because majority of folks who are abusing opioids are getting them from friends or from, you know, family. So, you know, the perception that tramadol may have reduced potential for abuse doesn't necessarily bear up, and so you need to monitor it, you know, closely. But also that perhaps if the purported mechanism of abuse, which is, you know, the opioid brain systems, that's also the mechanism by which pain relief is happening for tramadol, probably. But there are other mechanisms probably at play as well for pain patients that are going on. So tramadol's effects on pain aren't always going to be because of that prototypic opioid effect.